Christian Union for considering me this opportunity to come and minister and interact with you, my sons and daughters, most of you. Actually, you qualify to be my sons and daughters, as you have been told. I have grown up Kenyan people who voted in the last election. And they are voting again, so politicians need to talk to me nicely. I have votes in my house. Praise the Lord. Yeah, we are talking about inner healing. And the person who left here earlier said, we carry around wounds in our hearts. We may be smartly dressed. Sometimes we may make fun and be outgoing, and we may look like everything is good. Like we saw Bahati looking very smart and looking sharp. But deep inside, there are wounds that are covered. That once somebody says something or does something gross to something that was done to you in the years past, that wound starts to hoose again with blood or pus or whatever it is. Ask your neighbor for me. Do you have a wound? Or what's the cause of your wound? All of us do. But until you confront that wound, sometimes you think it is healed. Wait until something happens, and then it just pops open. As they were sharing here, I remembered an instance that took place in my own life. At the time when I was planning my wedding, resources were scarce. And one of my relatives came to the committee and volunteered to do a video shooting for me. Said, committee, don't think about the video. That one I will take care. And he also took some cards to raise some finances. And when I followed him up, he said, I have raised some finances, but I'm waiting until I get everything, then I will give it to you. And he never brought any money. And on the day, the Friday before my wedding, the Thursday before my wedding, I called him up so that we may link up on at what point will they come in with the video shooting. Those days, video shooting was very rare. Very few people did it, and it's something I dreamt. I actually had forgotten buying my wedding gown. I had to borrow a wedding gown because I wanted to have a video for memory. And this man, I called him on a Thursday, and I'm asking him, so at what point are you starting to do video? And he told me, oh, you know what? Actually, I'm not going to be there. I've gotten a commitment that I must attend. My brother is paying down. And so I must be there. I told him, you're not serious. He said, yeah, it's unfortunate, I won't be there. I said, okay, can't anybody else do it? He says, I have nobody to do it. And that was the end. And that pained me. I didn't know how much that hurt. Until some years later when I have my baby Vicky, and we were having Bible study in our church about forgiveness. And we were asked to share, is there somebody who has hurt you so deep that you have not talked about it or you have not overcome it? And as I remembered him, and I started narrating to the people what had happened. And I broke down and wailed like somebody was in pain. It's when I knew that I had not healed. It had gone years, I already had a child, but the pain was so much. But that day, I gave it to the Lord, and he healed me. And that's why I can speak it to you, and I'm not wailing now. Praise the name of the Lord. What I'm trying to say to all of you listening to me, everyone, smart as they may look, sometimes when you are in pain, or when you have gone through something, you are carrying a wound, or when you are having an emotional wound, you look around and you see everybody so happy, you feel like you are the only one. But I'm here to tell you, you are not alone. Everyone has gone through some kind of a pain. Everyone has been hurt. Everybody has gone through grief. Everybody has gone through an experience of having a broken heart or a wound. Did you hear what I just said? Because it is impossible to live life without experiencing pain. We live in a fallen world. The world that was perfect, that God created, that had no pain, that had no sorrow, that had no grief, that had no wounds, was the world that was in the Garden of Eden. But when our parents, our father Adam and our mother Eve, failed to follow through the commandments of God or the instructions of God, they sold us out to the world of pain and grief. Actually, to some people, they go through so much pain in life that actually their life can be defined by just pain. No, they have pain after pain until they have so many wounds and so many scars that they view everything that happens to them in life as one more attempt to cause pain. And maybe that is you. While I was thinking about this, I came across some portion of scripture that really ministered to me and resonated well with what we are talking about today. And that is from the book of John, chapter 5. John chapter 5. This is the story about the man that was healed at the pool of Bethesda. Verse 3 says, in this lay a great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the water. Multitude of sick people. Seated here are multitudes of sick people, only that they are not saved. People who have wounds, people who have pain, because it is the sick that needs healing. And so we are talking about inner healing. For us to be healed, we must be sick, isn't it? Isn't that true? There are so multitudes of sick people. Verse 5 says, now a certain man was there who had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he already had been in that condition a long time, he said to him, do you want to be made well? The sick man answered him, sir, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up. But while I am coming, another steps down before me. Jesus said to him, rise, take up your bed and walk. And immediately the man was made well, took up his bed and walked. Praise the name of the Lord. And so you can see the sickness is not, or pain or wounds or hurt, is not just for one person. Here we see a multitude. And as I've said, everybody has been hurt. Everybody has had a wound. Some people's wounds have been healed and so they have turned into scars. But some people's wounds are still, they are still fresh. Multitudes, great multitude. Another thing we see from this portion of scripture, that even amongst the multitude, I thank God that even when you are seated in this multitude and you feel like you are insignificant, or you feel that nobody knows you, you feel like nobody understands what you are going through, I am so thankful that we have a God who can single you out from the multitude. And that's what happened to this man that we are not given his name. The Bible says, now a certain man was there. This man, I believe, he had been the one carrying the wound the longest. He was the one who had been sick the longest, because the Bible says he had had this infirmity for 38 years. And amazing that people would come in, and because maybe they were not as hurt or as wounded, they were not as sick, they were strong enough to get themselves into the healing or into the pool. But his condition was so bad that he was not able to help himself. And so Jesus saw him. I thank God that we serve the Lord Jesus who sees. And Jesus knew that he already had been in that condition a long time. I am saying this, children of God, you may be here in the multitude of people. And I've told you, everyone here seated, it's already that they have not told you their story. And some of them, they cover their stories with so much jokes and fun. And you think they have everything together. But they are only doing that to suit themselves because of the pain that is within. And so in that multitude, Jesus is able to single you out and deal with you as an individual. Praise the name of the Lord. Because he sees and he knows. He understands each one of us. The condition you have, how long you have been in it. How it came about, the Lord knows and he understands. Praise the name of the Lord. And so this is where Jesus comes in and asks a very crucial question. And it is the same question that I will ask you today, or the same question that Jesus is asking this morning. He asked this man, do you want to be made well? A very good question for someone who had come to the pool of Bethesda and has been there for 38 years, waiting for help for 38 years. And somebody comes along, a stranger, and asks, do you want to be made well? In my thinking, I thought that this man had been there for so long, had tried and failed so many times, seen many people walk away healed until he had given up, and he had given up and resigned that his fate was to suffer and be in that condition forever. Maybe that is you. You have been in that state of pain and hurt and agony and anguish and affliction until you have resigned to the, to understanding that that is your portion in life, that some of us were meant to suffer. So he was there watching. He had just resigned to watch how people rejoiced as they got well. But he seems to have lost any hope or any desire or expectation of healing. Such that when Jesus asked this simple question, do you want to be made well? Simple as it is, that could have received a simple resounding answer, yes, I do. He did not have that answer because he had resigned. He had tried, he had given up. And so, just like many of us who may be seated here and you don't think that anything can be done to your situation, this question Jesus was asking did not need this man to do anything. He just needed to answer, yes, I do. And the one who was to make him well could do the work. But he went into stories and excuses, just like many of us do. The sick man answered, sir, I have no man. The question was not, how come you are not getting into the pool? Then the answer is given could have been appropriate, saying, I have no man. But now you see, he was preoccupied with his need and the things that were in his head is poor me, oh yeah, I have nobody, nobody cares. Such that even when the Lord of Lords and King of Kings, who cares so much, was standing right beside him, he could not sense the love and the care and the attention that was being given to him, having been picked out of the multitude. Today here I'm speaking to you, and Jesus will pick you from this multitude and address you and speak to you into your situation. I pray that you will not be like this man and say, my situation is complicated. Nobody can understand my situation. Jesus is asking a simple question. Do you want to be made well? Do you want to be healed of that emotional wound you have carried over the years? Do you want to be relieved of that grief and pain and sorrow that you have carried along for many years? May the Lord give you the grace to say, Lord, I am willing. I do. I am willing. And so the man went into excuses, saying, I have no man to put me into the pool. And he says, now, even besides that, every time when I try to come, somebody else runs out and I am cut out. Maybe that has been your situation. Anytime you try something, somebody else is favored. I have been walking around and I've seen there have been campaigns. People were campaigning to be elected into various posts. And maybe you were doing that and somebody else ran ahead and was voted and you were left out. You can feel nobody cares, nobody loves me, nobody is there for me. And this was the same situation for this man. I have seen something happen also many times in campuses. Young people are fond of hurting one another. Where you find a brother was starting to talk to a sister, they were trying to have some things starting to move. And another brother comes in and just cuts the line and the brother is left there wondering, what happened? I was just coming, and then somebody went ahead. And you may feel, it is because I'm like this, it's because I come from this place, it's because I don't have, some of them will say, maybe because I don't have parents. And the enemy takes you back into feeling sorry for yourself. The Lord Jesus is asking, do you want to be made well? What will your answer be? And I thank God for the Lord Jesus Christ, that even when we don't know what we want, He already knows what is good for us. And so this man, despite the fact of being unable to answer this question, Jesus went ahead and ignored all his excuses. And he said, rise, take up your bed and walk. In other words, shut up. Stop giving excuses and blaming people. Take charge over your life. Rise up. Can you tell the neighbor, the person sitting next to you, rise up. Nothing is going to happen in your life until you rise up. You need to rise up in the inside. You need to gather yourself. You need to put yourself together and rise up and shake those things that have held you down. Because emotional wounds, hurts, pains from the past can totally paralyze your future. They can hinder you totally from progressing. Because they affect our behavior, they affect our attitude, they affect the way we interact with the people. If you have ever met someone who is emotionally wounded, they are not pleasant people to stay around. You try to understand them, you try to love them, and at the moment when you are trying to love them, they're going back, and they leave you wondering, what have I done? Because they are afraid to be hurt, they end up hurting other people. As somebody has said, hurt people, hurt people. So you need to rise up. You need to come to a point and say, I don't want to live this way. And so you need to rise up. And I say, you will. And Jesus gave this command, saying, rise up. Take charge of your life. This man had been on this bed for that 8 years. This bed had covered him. He had no authority, he had no power over anything in his life. He was at the mercy of this bed that carried him. This situation, this, you know, catastrophe or sort of event that has carried this man this far. Jesus said, now rise up, take charge over it. That which has controlled your life for 38 years, for 3 years, for 10 years, rise up, take charge over it, and let it be under your feet. Praise the name of the Lord. And so, children of God, from that portion of scripture, the Lord ministered to my heart. And I realized this, that Jesus sees, he knows, he has power to heal, but you have to be wanting and willing to be made whole. Did you hear what I say? He sees, he knows, there's nothing you are going through or nothing you are going through that Jesus is not aware. He is omniscient. He knows everything about your life. The Bible says even your very heirs are numbered. And none of them will fall down without his knowledge. There's like nothing, no hurt, no pain, no sorrow, no grief, no loss that you can go through that he has not, is not aware. Or that he has not allowed, especially for you who is a born again believer. And I just ask you, everything that happens into our life, he weighs it in his hands. Remember, when the devil wanted to torment Job, he did it only by permission from God. And so nothing happens to you. He knows, and he has power to heal you, but you have to be willing, and you have to want to be made whole. And so I will encourage you to stop excuses, and the justifications, and the blaming game. You know, saying, oh, my situation is different. You know, those kind of arguments, when you hear the word of God like this, and you start arguing and saying, no, my situation is different. If you knew my story, it is different. Stop those justifications, or you start pointing fingers and say, those people, what they did, leave them alone, stop it, in Jesus' name. But I also want you to know that it all begins with an encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ. It is Jesus who makes the difference in our life. This man had been at the pool for that 8 years. I believe politicians had visited, great men and women had visited, but nobody had power to minister healing into him. It's only Jesus, the Son of the living God, that is able to heal you beyond that which a human being can see or do. Have you encountered Jesus? I shared in the second service that while I was a young girl in high school, I lost my brother, whom I loved so much. My brother had given me great promises, encouraging me to work hard in school, and the future was bright as long as my brother was ahead. But then he passed away, The very week I finished my Form 4 exam, my brother passed on. And by the time my exams were out, I had passed so well. But my brother was not there to celebrate with me. And as I went to high school, to Form 5 and 6, I was a grieving girl. I cried every day. I had no peace. I was so sorrowful. Life for me had turned upside down. But in that sorrowfulness, that's when Christ broke through into my heart. That's when I received Jesus as Lord and Savior. When I used to see him. And when I did that, he took my grief away. He took my pain and my sorrow away. And he gave me joy. I knew and I realized there is life after death. When I see you. So you need to encounter Christ. If you are here and you don't know the Lord in a personal way, and you have gone through so much pain, through so much sorrow, you have grief or you have pain or wounds in your heart, I want to tell you, my sister, my brother, my son and daughter, it begins by opening your heart to the Palm of Gilead, to the great physician who is the Lord Jesus Christ. When he comes in, he will heal your heart. Hallelujah. Amen. And so, having said that, I want to quickly give you a few biblical steps towards inner healing or towards the healing of the inner man. Number one, the first thing I want you to know, we have all said, we all agree that everybody has their share of pain or of a wound, or they have gone through some stuff. Anybody who has gone through some stuff, can I see your hand? I'm not going to ask you to say which one it is. Maybe you don't need this message. I realize many people here have not gone through any pain, but you are all liars. The truth is we have lost loved ones. We have been rejected. We have been blamed for things we didn't do. We have been mistreated, we have been mishandled. You know, we have gone through stuff, all of us. Some of us, thankfully, the Lord has healed us, so we have scars, we don't have wounds. Because the difference between a scar and a wound is that the wound is still raw and painful, but the scar is just a sign, it's one of the ornaments of what we have suffered in this life. But it is a simple. Paul said, let no man bother me, I bear the scars of Christ on my body. And so, if you have scars, praise the Lord, those are ornaments. It shows that you have gone through this world. But if you have a wound, I want you to hear me. Number one, I want you to know that God wants to heal your wounds. God wants to heal your pain and to heal your hearts and sorrow. Please let nobody deceive you or let no devil deceive you to the fact that the sufferings you are going through or the heartaches you are going through, it is God instigating. Because that is the lie the enemy will give to many people until they turn their backs on God. I was in Chuka last year when one girl confided in me that since their mom, who was a single mother, died, her brother, who was a born-again Christian, has never looked towards the door of the church because she felt God treated them unfairly. So I want you to know that the sufferings and the heartaches we go through in this world, it is because we live in a fallen world. Hello? God never intended it from the beginning. But the disobedience of man in the Garden of Eden brought about all that we see. So because we live in a fallen world, we will experience pain and heartache. But with all that, you need to understand that God wants to heal your wound. He desires to do so. And he does this because he loves you. He loves you and he loves me so much. He loves us that he has paid the price for our emotional healing in the work of the cross of Jesus Christ. The Bible says in Isaiah 53 and verse 4, surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. Jesus carried, he knew God loves us so much and he saw the struggle of the human life and human heart without the pain and the agony. That's why Jesus came to bear, to carry our sorrow. And the word sorrow here, the New Testament Greek, tells us that this word sorrow literally refers to anguish, affliction, grief, pain. So Jesus has carried all that. He took these things and paid the price with his own blood for us. So you need to know that God desires to heal your broken heart and bind up your wounds. And I just finish. Because knowledge is power. The Bible says that people perish for lack of what? Lack of knowledge. You need to know and be convinced in your heart that God is interested in healing that wound. God is interested. God desires. He wants to do that. The Bible says in Psalm 147 and verse 3, He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. So, if you want to receive healing from emotional wounds, it is vital that you take advantage of what Christ has done for us and learn to cast your cares upon the Lord. Not just some, but all of them, knowing that He cares for you and wants to take those things from you. Peter encourages us in 1 Peter 5 and 7, casting all your care upon Him, for He cares for you. Whatever that is, cast it upon the Lord. He cares for you. Please tell your neighbor for me, cast it upon the Lord. Whatever it is, just cast it upon the Lord. He cares for you. And when you cast it, you don't go back and pick it up. Because that's what many of us do. We come to the cross and we monitor and we say, Lord, I leave this, I give it. And as soon as you rise up, you pick it up and you go home with it. Because for some of us, we have become comfort. We get comforted to rehearse and go through what we have gone through. And because that's when people sympathize with us and say, well, yeah. You know, we want to people to sympathize always as you narrate your story. So you feel if you leave it at the feet of Christ, you will have no story to tell. I want to encourage you. When you cast it, leave it there. When I use your spirit. In other words, number two, I'm saying release. Release those hearts, those painful and fearful emotions into the hands of Jesus Christ. Hanging on to those pains blocks the healing power of the Holy Spirit in your soul. It is vital to open up and allow the Lord to heal your wounds. And I people like holding on to those wounds. Somebody will want to tell the story. I have related with people who will tell you what they have gone through. They will tell you this year, and next year when you meet, they start again like they never told you before. And so they go over it again. And now we have counselors who are making money out of that. They want you to go into their office so that you tell them the story of your pain. And then they listen. And every 1 hour is 3,000 shillings. And after you are done, you go home and come back next month or next year and say the same story. I thank God that Jesus doesn't do that. He says, release it. When you release it to the Lord, He takes it away. He has carried our sorrows. Praise the name of the Lord. The Bible says in Luke 4:18, Jesus declared His mission for coming on earth. He says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Listen to what He says next. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted. Praise the name of the Lord. Amen. To heal the brokenhearted. To preach deliverance to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind. Then He finally said, to set at liberty them that are bruised. Jesus wants to set you free from your wounds, from your pains, from the bruises that life has offered you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
When you realize that Jesus paid the price for the healing of your soul, and He did that to set you free from bondage, so that you not come under the bruises or the bondage of the bruises that you have received in life, you will start loosening up. Somebody has said, when life serves you with lemons, make lemonade out of it. Praise the name of the Lord. So many of us have gone through issues. You need to loosen up and know that you can release them to Jesus and He will turn them out, because nothing has happened to you for nothing. God never wastes any hurt or any pain. Whatever pain He has allowed you to go through is because He wants to use it for His own glory. He's preparing a ministry for you.
Amen.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
So it is important to God that we receive this inner healing, because His Son paid a costly price for it. You can read that in Matthew 11, 28 to 30. And so all that I'm saying is that allow your painful emotions to be released as you give them to the Lord. Because holding on to those pains and hurts will only prevent you from being healed. I have tried counseling. As a pastor, I counsel many people. But there are people who come, and you listen to them, and when you try to help them know what the Word of God says, he said, but pastor, you don't understand. Pastor, maybe it's because you are not in my shoe. There is nothing I can do. I can only tell you what the Word of God says. When I use a sphere. So release it to the Lord. Number three, realize the love of God for you. Because if you realize the love of God for you, it will help you to open up and receive inner healing. Knowing the true nature of our Heavenly Father will help us to trust Him and to open ourselves up so that we can receive the healing that only the Holy Spirit can provide for us. You see, when we are going through pain or when we are in a hurt, many times the enemy will turn around and whisper into our ears that God hates you. Or God doesn't like you. Maybe God is punishing you. How many of you have ever had things like that? Maybe God is punishing you. You know, and then he starts showing you what you have done wrong. That's what the people who specialize in generational curses, that's what they do. They will take you through generations. The curses, you know, they break them today, and next year, they take you through generational curses. The Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Behold, the old has passed, and everything has become new. Praise the name of the Lord. You need to understand the nature of our God, that our God is love. And that our God loves us, not because of anything we have done, or anything that we will ever do. He has loved us out of his own free will, out of his own volition. It's not that we can earn his love. There's nothing you can do to make God happy, or to please or appease God. And I just feel it. For the Bible says our own, you know, righteousness, our own goodness is just like filthy rags before God. And so you need to understand the nature of our God. The Bible tells us in Romans 8 and 32 that he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Praise the name of the Lord. He loved us enough to give his son to die for us. Why could he withhold other things from us? He loves us so much. And please, if you care to know, I want you to know that God loves you with the same measure of love with which he loves Jesus Christ. That's what the Bible tells us in the book of John 15 and verse 13. That he loves us with the same measure of love, equal love. He doesn't love us less. That is the God I serve. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. He is a God of love, not some headmaster waiting to see when I falter, then he knocks me on the hand. That's not my God. I serve a loving Father. When I see fear. Number four, realize God's will for your mind and receive it. The greatest battles that you will never fight, child of God, is not the battle with the Banyamweses or Al-Shabaab. The greatest battle we have is the battle of the mind. If you can take hold of your mind, if you can control your mind, and one of the Bible says that we need to gather the loins of our mind. When you look at that scripture, gather the loins of your mind, it is actually a picture of somebody who has a big rope of clothes that are flowing all over, that they need to fold them up in order to ease their progress in walking. So our mind sometimes it spreads so far and wide, and it fails to serve the purposes of God because of the way it runs. It goes against the will of God. The Bible tells us in 2 Timothy 1:7 that God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Every Christian is entitled to a sound mind. A healed mind, a whole mind, not suffering from memories, you know, painful memories. Having painful memories is not a sound mind. But I use a simple. A sound mind is a healed mind. And that's the will of God for us, that we will have a sound mind. But I use a simple. And And so that's why the Bible also tells us in Romans 12 that we are not to conform to the patterns of this world. We are not to think the way the world thinks. We should not imitate the way the world does things, but we should be transformed by the renewing of our mind. It is only then that we can be able to know the will of God, not just the will of God, the good will of God and the perfect will of God. So child of God, whatever it is, regarding that very pain, find the will of God. What is the mind of God regarding that which you have gone through? When Job came to understand what the mind of God regarding the pain he was going through, he declared and said, Lord God, forgive me. I have just had you with the hearing of the ear, but now I have seen you with my own eyes. And I spoke whatever I said, I did it in foolishness. When I used to say thing. Because he came to see the intended end. So may God help you to understand that for every emotional pain you have gone through, for every sorrow, for every mistreatment that you have had, God has a purpose for it. And so find the will of God and the mind of God for that pain. And number five, extend forgiveness towards those who have hurt you. This is very important. Please understand, I'm not arranging them in any chronological order or in any order of importance. May the Lord help you to pick out the point that most applies to you. Extend forgiveness towards those who have hurt you. If there is one emotional pain or anything that the enemy will actually hold against Christians on the day of judgment, is unforgiveness. True or false? Because people are in church and they are carrying bitterness. They are carrying people in their hearts. People have hurt them. Just like the skits, the play that was done here. Memories from high school, from childhood, what uncles did to you, what parents did, what brothers did, what, you know, things that people did to you. Understand that whatever people have done to you is because they are human. Please tell your neighbor they are human. It is the human nature to hurt one another. We are actually, we are more of like animals. We live in a jungle where everybody for himself and God for us all. And so because of that, we always find reason to hurt one another. So if they hurt you, it's because they were being human. But also think about the other people you have hurt. When you refuse to forgive someone, remember the many others you have also hurt. Because the Bible says that the measure with which you will give others, the same will be measured to you. The people you have hurt, if they chose not to forgive you, how many will be holding you? But the worst thing about unforgiveness is that it hurts you, the one who is not forgiving. It doesn't hurt the person who is not forgiving. It is you that will have ulcers. It is you that will have blood pressure. It is you that will have nightmares. While they are sleeping in their bed soundly, you are there thinking about them. You can't catch sleep. Wasame water. That's what some Simon Kubwa, or is that the man who has said, Ime wasame water. Ime wasame water. And another thing I said, if you keep people in your heart, moyo wako utapasuka bure. Chipe raha mwenyewe. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. So extend forgiveness. It is vital to release those feelings that you have against other people so that the Holy Spirit's healing and forgiving power can heal and restore your soul. Please hear me, children of God. And forgiveness, whatever it is that somebody did to you, whether they killed your parents or they hurt you and cut your leg, and forgiveness is a deadly poison to you, the one who's not forgiving. So, at your own time, look at Mark 11, 25 and 26. Bible says, if you do not forgive, neither will your Father, which is in heaven, forgive your trespasses. And that's why Jesus taught us and said, when you pray, say, forgive us our trespasses in the equal measure that we forgive those who trespass against us. If God was to forgive you in the equal measure that you forgive other people, how forgiven will you be today? So, you know better. How forgiven will you be today? If God measured forgiveness. Some of us forgive, say, I have forgiven, but I will never forget. Nasema nimesamehe lakini sitasahau. There is a negative aspect of kutosahau. I said, whenever you remember a hurt or a pain or something somebody did to you and the pain comes back, that means you are not totally forgiven. Of course, you can't erase your memory from things that have happened, but you can erase the pain. When it is healed, it becomes a scar and it becomes a jewel that you put on. With which you can encourage other people of God. When you meet them and they told you, oh, I didn't dump. Oh, unamwambia usichaje, hata mimi nilitambiwa. Hata mimi nilitambiwa, lakini sasa nimeolewa. So, it becomes a jewel that you are not embarrassed about. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. So, for unforgiveness will block God's forgiveness from operating in our own lives. Inner healing requires God's forgiveness. Read Matthew 18, 32 to 35 at your own time. And number 6, realize who you are in Christ. If there is one crisis that we have in the church, not only in the church, actually in life, in this generation, is an identity crisis. People who are depending so much on what other people say to validate them, to validate who they are. And that's why we post new pictures on Facebook or Instagram every other day. We post and we post. And when people say, cute, wonderful, you feel good about it. And then tomorrow, when you feel bad about yourself, you post another one. And people boost you, like you keep getting injections, so you look good. So, you are busy checking how many people have commented, what have they said about me? Because people have an identity crisis. May God help you to realize who you are in Christ and be comfortable in your skin. Praise the name of God. Tell the person next to you, be comfortable in your skin. You are valuable. You are important. You are priceless. You are wonderfully and fearfully made in the image of God and after His likeness. When I was just and suppose if only I would have been a little taller. You cannot be, because Jesus said, who among you by worry will add an inch to himself? And some say, if only I could be a little light. So they go getting some of the creams. So you look at a sister, a daughter, in this case. You see their hands, they are African. Their face. And you are wondering, what's happened? This is strange. Simply because people are not comfortable in who they are. May God help you to know that your value is not in the academic papers you will get. Your value is not in the amount of money that you will earn. Your value is not in the kind of car you will drive. Your value is not in the kind of a house or which side of the city you will stay. Your value, you are simply priceless because you are you. Praise the name of God. Don't allow people to dictate how you feel or what you think about yourself. Simply because somebody has said you are useless. And then you walk walking around and say, they say I'm useless. Who said? The maker has not said so. The father says, I value you. You are the apple of my eye. I rejoice over you with singing. Praise the name of the Lord. Dear eyes, regardless of what it is, there will never be another you. I don't have all the time to go into that, but number 7, embrace God's forgiveness. Embrace God's forgiveness. You cannot receive inner healing as long as you are walking in guilt and the condemnation. There are so many people, Christians, who Jesus forgave long time ago, threw their sins into the sea of forgetfulness. But they walk around as people who are condemned, and they walk in guilt. Anytime they want to rise up, the devil whispers to them, remember what you did, and they go down. May the Lord help you to know that we serve a God who forgives, He delights, He rejoices, He enjoys forgiving us. And so He tells us in Psalms 103 verse 12, as far as the east is from the west, so far as He removed our transgressions from us. And in Isaiah 43:25, I am he that blotted out the transgressions for my own sake, and will not remember your sins. When I used to feel. Embrace God's forgiveness. Let me tell you, I am a pastor, but I make mistakes lots of times. I sin. I do wrong. I think things that I shouldn't think. But I have learned that the thing that will make me acceptable to God is not because I'm living a holy life. Many times we deceive ourselves and lie that we are so holy. We live in deception. The Bible says a broken spirit and a contrite heart, God will never despise. So embrace God's forgiveness. He has forgiven you. Receive his forgiveness and walk in freedom. When the devil tries to remind you, let the devil know that I don't remember. What I remember is that I'm forgiven. I am a saint, I'm a child of God. I'm going to heaven. Praise the name of the Lord. Amen. And then with that, we will receive healing. There's no other way to be healed apart from having an encounter with Christ Jesus, embracing the word of God, feeding on the word of God. Have your mind transformed. Because our souls, as I said earlier, they are made up, I said in the first service, our soul is made up of three things. It's made up of our will, our emotions, and our mind. And that's where our battles lie. If we overcome them, then we will live a victorious Christian life. May God bless you. I pray and speak healing into your life. In Jesus' name. You need to rise up and take up that situation by the horns and put it down in the name of Jesus Christ. And live a victorious, a healed life. You will have scars. Battles are ornaments. And I wish I would assure you that your sorrows and your pains and the hearts are over. They will only end when we see Christ face to face. As long as we are in this world, the Bible tells us, we will have many sorrows, but we cheer up because Christ has overcome. Shall we rise up? No pain that is so severe that Christ cannot relieve us and heal us. There is no loss that is so pain that Christ cannot replenish. And so, go before God, lift up your hands to him, and surrender. Release that pain to him. Release. As we sing this chorus, I surrender.